Instead of spending $450, I could have achieved the same kind of look and result for $150. Hey guys, welcome back to my channel. So on YouTube and Reddit, I get asked a lot about how I make my food videos. It's usually from people who are trying to make food videos on YouTube. So if you're an upcoming YouTuber that's looking to set up a kitchen, well, this video is perfect for you. Since I already did all the hard work, you would just need to pick out the right setup for your budget. In this video, I'm going to showcase different setups for making food videos on YouTube. Before we begin, let me know what setup you think cost me the most. Let me know in the comments below. There are a total of 3 setups in this video, setup 1, 2, and 3. And the price ranges from $100 to $500. And later in the video, I'm going to break down each setup by price, so stay tuned for that. Towards the end, I'm going to go over how to mix and match and make your perfect setup. By the way, this is a part of the video where I ask you to subscribe and like this video. If you already haven't, just hit the like button. It's free for you. It doesn't cost you anything. It would literally take you less than a second to hit that like, and this would help me out tremendously. So I started making YouTube videos about a year ago, and over that time, I went from this to this. And getting to the current setup took a lot of time, effort, and money. During the daytime, I have a full-time job, so making videos using natural sunlight is not an option for me. As you can see, my kitchen is pretty yellow, and the lights are pretty dim during the nighttime. Since I do all my recording at nighttime, I had to invest in some lights. So last year, when I started on making food videos, I had no clue how to get set up. The very first time I recorded my food video was using an iPhone and just my kitchen light, and the result was really bad. Here's what it looked like. So I had to do something about it. After reading up and doing some research, I landed on the following as my first setup. This current setup costs $100 and is really budget friendly. One quick mention, I don't factor in the price of a camera because I'm gonna assume that everybody has a smartphone that they could use to record videos. Here's a full price breakdown for this setup. The lights cost $60, phone mount would cost $33, and the cutting board would cost $10, but it's optional in case you don't have one. So the very first lights that I bought were called HP USN, and for $60, I think it's a really good bargain because you get 2 of everything. It comes with 2 tripods, 2 85 watt bulbs, which they claim to say it's configured at 5500K. And a complete softbox kit. And overall, it comes in a very nice carrying case. So when you're not using it, you could easily stow it and put it away. Out of the 3 different lights that I'm going to showcase today, this is by far the easiest one to set up. It's basically plug and play, you hook up your bulb, put your diffuser on, and you're ready to go. Finally, you would just need to put it all on the tripod. Overall, it takes maybe a minute to set up each light. Once it's set up, it looks like this. Here's the light turned on with no diffusion. The lights are pretty harsh, but you can easily overcome that by putting on the diffuser that they provide. And here's what it looks like with the diffuser. That's all the equipment that I use for the $100 setup, and now I'm going to show you how I set up the kitchen for making food videos. For recording this video, I've set up this food plate, which has some cookies, some fruit, and a bottle of Nutella. I'll be using this plate to showcase all the different setups. And I'm also going to show the videos which I use this equipment in. One thing to make sure is when you're setting up lights, you want to make sure that the angle is at a 45 degree angle. Doing this will light up your food more properly, otherwise your food video won't be so bright. Using this setup, here's what the video would look like from the side and from the top using an iPhone. Since I won't be able to hold my phone forever, I needed a proper overhead camera setup. I found a solution from this YouTuber called Ronnie Joseph, which I'll link down below. You would need a total of 3 parts to get this working. I'll go ahead and link them down below in the description so you could see. The very first thing you need is the microphone stand, which I'm holding and attaching right now. You would also need a universal phone holder and a thread-based mount. You can easily hook this up to the countertop as I'm showing it to you. Literally takes seconds to do that. The good thing about this stand is that it gives you the flexibility to move it around. Basically, you can configure this at any angle. Once you have the overhead phone mount all tightened up, you are then ready to put in your phone. It's really easy to just drop in the phone and then just tighten it with this screw that I'm showing right now. And once it's all hooked up, you can move this around. One thing you want to make sure that all the screws are tightened properly, because if you don't have everything tightened up, the overhead mount would shake a lot. Especially like when you're cutting stuff or when you're using power mixers. If you don't have it properly tightened, then this phone mount would start shaking and rattling. And as a result, this will impact your video quality. But overall, this is the entire setup at a glance. We have the lights, we have the overhead phone mount, and we have my sample plate. Once we start recording, this is how the video would look like. Also, I'm using this cutting board that I picked up from Target for $10. The cutting board is optional in case you don't have one. For testing out each setup, I decided to also cut an onion. This is mainly to mimic a cooking video when you're cutting and chopping stuff. So for spending $100 and using your own phone, this is the type of video that you would be able to produce. If you do want to check out the full videos that I'm showing here, then head over to Toasty Foods YouTube channel. This used to be my old channel. These are all made last year in 2019. Here's another angle using an iPhone from the side. I'm just trying to give you all the angles that are possible so you have a better understanding of the setup. Setup number one is only $100 and it's a really bare bones setup to get you started for recording and making YouTube videos. From this setup, the best thing are the lights. For $60, the lights are pretty decent for the money, and the $33 phone mount will help you make tasty style food videos. But you can easily use the same setup to record any other type of overhead videos where you draw, sketch, or do any other type of work. Later in the video, I'm going to show you how you can improve this $100 setup by going to Home Depot. And this is what that looks like, so stay tuned, I'll show this towards the end of the video. Moving on to the next setup, setup number two. This setup costs around $250. The main thing that drives up the cost are the lights and some additional changes like buying wood and putting a proper background. Here's the full price breakdown. The lights normally cost around $170. The phone mount cost $33. The wood which will be used for the background costs around $30. But you can also buy cheaper wood for way less than that. Buying additional plates would cost $10. And finally, the cutting board would cost $10 in case you already don't have one. Here's what the setup looks like at full glance. Again, all the links are below in the description, so do check that out. I'll start by showcasing the lights first for this setup. For the lights, I went with Neura 660. As the name suggests, this has 660 tiny LED bulbs in there. This set comes with a pair of lights. You get two of everything, two LED lights, two stands, which are pretty durable, and you also get two soft boxes. Unlike the HP USN from setup one, the stands are pretty durable. This set comes with a nice carrying case where you could put in your LED lights, but you don't get any carrying case for the tripod. It would have been nice if they provided an overall carrying case so you could easily transport your setup anywhere you would go. One additional feature that this LED has is it has barn doors, which are all metal. The barn doors give you the flexibility for focusing or properly directing light. At this point, I forgot that this was upside down, but I later corrected it. But the overall light setup is pretty easy. All you do is drop in your LED into the tripod and tighten the bolt. And here's what that looks like. Next, plug in your power cord and turn on the light. The best feature on this light is that it contains a knob where you can change the brightness or the color of the light. You can go from 3200 Kelvin to 5600 Kelvin. In simple terms, 3200 Kelvin means soft white, which is typically yellow light, whereas 5600 Kelvin would mean daylight or more bluish tone. The next thing that I want to showcase for this setup number two is the background. For this, I went to the Home Depot, more specifically the lumber section towards the back. In this section, you could find pre-cut plywood, which is what I picked out. The price ranges anywhere from like $8 all the way up to like $30. So when you go there, do check out the one that's perfect for you. I ended up choosing birch plywood, which costs $27. The reason I chose this is because it has a nice texture. The cheaper woods have a bad texture, plus they're thinner. Optionally, if you want to be more creative, you can buy some wood stain or spray paint. This would cost around $5 or so, but staining the wood really protects it from any spillage. If you drop any oil or water into the wood, then your wood is ruined, so in order to protect it, you want to put some wood stain on it, or at least put spray paint. Here I'm converting one of my old boards, which was painted gray, into white by using spray paint. For only a few bucks, you could really transform your background as you would like, and you could be as creative as you want with that background. I still, till this day, keep experimenting. That's all the equipment that I used for setup number two, and now I'm going to show you how to set up this kitchen using this equipment. Next, I hook up the overhead mount. Now, I went over all the specifics for how to set up this overhead mount in the setup number one, so do check that out if you have skipped over or missed it. And then adjust the lights itself by turning it up or down, and adjusting the barn doors as needed. The major difference between setup number one lights and setup number two lights is that First, you can adjust the brightness and the color. And second, you could adjust the barn doors and make it more focused light. Next, I place the wooden background. And here's what it looks like when you turn on the lights and also when you adjust the brightness from dark to bright. Here's what the setup looks like when you use an iPhone or any other smartphone. And here's what it looks like when you have your iPhone connected to the overhead mount. At full glance, here's the overall setup. We have the LED lights that are pointed towards the food. We have the phone mount connected with the iPhone on it. We have the wooden background that we got from Home Depot. And we finally have my test plate, which is filled with some grapes, some cookies, and a bottle of Nutella. Next, I'm gonna do the onion test. This is just to mimic how you would chop food when you're making actual food videos. This is that tasty channel look that everybody goes for these days. And here are the videos that I made on this channel using these lights and the setup. Feel free to check these videos out by going to my playlist or checking out my previous videos. Fun fact, the most popular video on this channel is that Cheesecake Factory bread recipe. To be fair, some of the shots were recorded using a Sony camera, but here's everything using an iPhone just to keep everything consistent and sane. I think compared to setup number one, this looks way better, but hang around till the end because I'm going to compare setup number one, two, and three side by side, and it will be much easier for you to decide then. The good thing about having a wooden background is that you can easily flip it. By now, I have like a couple of these boards painted different colors, but for this particular board, I have painted one side white and the other side is just stained. So if you do get this board, always remember to stain the wood, otherwise you're gonna get it ruined pretty easily while cooking. Here's how food looks like on a white background. And here's what everything looks like with a white background and a cutting board. In conclusion, this setup is okay for making food videos. This setup would be great if you're trying to control the brightness of your light or the color of your light. I personally think the wooden background really boosts the quality of the video, and this can be easily applied to any other setup that you currently have. And I still promise you I'm going to show you that $150 setup, which is basically the $100 setup, but it includes a wooden background, which really improves the content quality. The only issue I see with setup number two are the light. These lights cast a very strong shadow. And if you use the diffuser that it comes with, it really reduces the amount of light that comes out, so it becomes useless. And just because of that, I landed on setup number 3, that's my primary setup these days. Well, this setup actually costs $443, but just to keep everything simple, I rounded it up to $450. The main thing that drives up the price are the lights. They're the most expensive lights I think I've ever bought. So here's a full breakdown by component for this setup number 3. The lights cost $210 on average. The softbox, which you have to buy separately, costs $100. You would also need to buy the tripod separately, which roughly costs $30. The wood, along with some spray paint and some wood stain, would cost roughly $40. The ceramic tiles would substitute the cutting board, and they each cost $5. Since I used 4 of them, they're $20 total. The overhead phone mount would cost additional $33. And finally, some plates would cost you about $10 if you don't already have some. And here's a close-up of everything. Here's a full overview of all the equipment that's going to get used for this setup number 3. Like the previous setups, I'm going to start by showcasing the lights first. For this, I went with Godox SL150. As the name suggests, this light has an output of 150 watts. And this LED is by far really bright. Setting up this LED is pretty easy. All you need to do is drop it into your tripod, connect the power cord, and turn it on. It takes seconds to do this step. The other good thing about this light is that you can control the brightness by turning the knob. One limitation is that the light does not go below 10% brightness. You also get a remote for controlling the brightness. You can also turn on and off the light using the remote. And for some weird reason, the light would not go below 25% when you're using the remote. So when you're manually using the knob, the light does not go below 10%, and when you're using the remote, the light does not go below 25%. It must be some design flaw. I generally keep my brightness around 50 to 70%, so I'm not bothered by that. It's really useful when you're recording videos and you want to turn up or turn down the brightness. You have your remote in your pocket and you can quickly make that change. By the way, this is my opinion. I think this light would be on par with the Aputure 120D, which sells for almost $800. This being $209 is a really great bargain. So online, there are a lot of complaints that the fan is pretty loud on this light, but when I make my food videos, I don't hear the fan in the background. Now, you would also need to purchase a tripod and a softbox since the light does not come with one. Typically, you can find a good tripod for $30 on Amazon, which I'll link below. But at this point, I want to showcase the softbox, which is really huge. It's about 48 inches wide, or 4 feet. This softbox is from Glow Easy. One downside to this entire setup is that it takes a long time to set everything up. Since the softbox is 48 inches wide, it's really hard to manage. Opening and closing the softbox is really difficult at times. I normally just keep mine open all the time and put it in a living room. And here's how I open it. You need to apply a lot of pressure in order to make sure it clicks. Most of the time, it's really challenging to make it click properly. Once it's fully opened and assembled, this is what it looks like. And I came into the shot just to show how big it is. Maybe this video doesn't do justice, but it's really huge. But it's not that heavy, so it's easy enough to carry. Connecting the softbox with the Godox light is pretty easy. All you need to do is push it in and twist it so it clicks in. Here's what everything looks like once it's fully connected. The next thing you need to do is put on the diffuser. With this softbox, you get two types of diffusers, inner and outer diffuser. For my setup, I only use the inner diffuser, and here's what that looks like. As I keep the lights between 50 to 70%, I don't see a need for putting an outer diffuser. But if you do get this, do try out all the different combinations possible. Also, for this setup, I bought the wooden background from Home Depot and painted it gray. This was an expensive color, that's why the price is up on this setup. I discussed the full Home Depot run in my setup number 2 section of this video, so do skip back if you missed it. But for the setup number 3, I also improved the background even further using some tiles. Instead of using a wooden cutting board, I use a tile, and behind the wooden board I apply more tiles so that my kitchen looks more modern. So when I went to Home Depot, I settled for these tiles as they were cheap. They were $1.99 per square foot. Since this tile is 18 by 18, it would cost around $5 a piece. Home Depot does sell loose tiles, so do check out for that or ask their associates. So this is my routine for every time I make a food video. I start by attaching my light to the tripod. Then I remove the light cover and put on the softbox. In this entire setup 3, putting on the softbox to the light is the hardest part. Once the light is set up, then I start layering down the tiles. The tiles are there purely for aesthetics. They're there to improve my background even more. Next, I hook up the overhead mount. Now, I went over all the specifics for how to set up this overhead mount in the setup number 1, so do check that out if you have skipped over or missed it. Next, I place over my wooden board, which I painted weathered gray for this setup. I realized that the colored stains are more expensive than plain stains or spray paint. Lastly, I placed a tile, which I do all the cutting and chopping on. Basically, I replaced the wooden cutting board with a tile, and it works perfectly fine. In its glory, the setup number 3 looks like this. It's really bright, but the good part is you can always adjust it to your liking. It lights up the food very nicely. It does not cast any strong shadows, and overall, it's a very professional looking setup. But of course, it does cost a lot of money to get to this point. Here's what my mixed plate looks like using an iPhone. To me, it almost feels like daylight, even though I'm recording this video around 9 or 10 p.m. But of course, let me know your thoughts in the comments below if you liked setup 1, 2, or 3. With this setup, you can also adjust the brightness as you'd like using the remote. And here are all the videos that I've recently recorded using this setup. By recorded, I meant uploaded to YouTube. Do you think that this looks professional enough? Or do you think should I continue exploring more? And here are all the shots using iPhone. Can you tell the difference between the Sony camera and iPhone? On my computer, I can tell the difference, but when you upload this video to YouTube, you can hardly tell the difference. Finally, the moment that we have been waiting for. Here's a full side-by-side comparison of setup 1, 2, and 3. It's all ranging from $100 to $250 to $450. Here's another shot using an iPhone. Here's how the videos would look like if you use this setup with an iPhone. Again, let me know which one do you think looks the best. I personally like the way how setup number 3 looks, but if I had to start all over again, here's what I would do. Instead of spending $450, I could have achieved the same kind of result for $150. And here's what that would look like at full glance. You would use everything from setup 1, which is $100, and the only thing you would carry over from setup number 3 are the tiles and the wood, which cost additional $50. So altogether, your total would be $150. The main thing that drives the price are the lights. Now, you do see a little difference between all of them, but I think the $60 lights are good enough to get started. You do see a lot of yellowness in the $60 light, but if you use DaVinci Resolve or Premiere Pro, you can easily color correct it. And to prove you guys, here's a side-by-side comparison between the unedited and the color corrected version. But if you got the budget and are trying to look for perfection, then go for the Godox Lite. That was my opinion, now you tell me yours in the comments below. Which one do you think was the best light or the best setup overall? I hope you like this content, and if you'd like to see more, do subscribe and give me a like. Just give that like button a quick tap, it's free for you, and helps me out tremendously on my channel.